man cannot come glue with the definition, because he does exceeding abundantly above all I could ask or think. So here we thank God for the extravagant dimensions of his love. Just to hurry on with Dr. Pickin, with the text of where Paul is in Ephesians, the third chapter. You already know that he's in prison, but in the process, without going down and diving into what's going on in Ephesians 3, let me just skip through to the time. There's a thing that Paul mandates of us in Ephesians, the third chapter. He says, and I want you to hear this, he said, because it is your time to live an extravagant lifestyle and to experience the overflow of God's love. There are three things that he said we must embrace or we must experience. According to Ephesians, the third chapter, verse 16 and 17. First, let's deal with verse 16 and 17. It said that if you are going to experience an extravagant lifestyle, get ready for this, your life must be controlled by the Holy Ghost. I know we don't talk about the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, the Holy whatever. You can call it a ghost, you can call it a spirit, as long as it's holy, all right? So I know we don't deal with that a lot, because people have become intimidated by the Holy Ghost. And because those of us that have been saving in the church for a long time, we've only made people in the exclusive club have access to the Holy Ghost. We've only allowed the people we like, we enjoy, to have access to the Holy Ghost. But Acts 19 and 2 say, have you received since you believed? It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what denomination. Because what I found out about the Holy Ghost, it is not relegated to the Church of God in Christ, the Baptist Church, the non-denomination. But the Holy Ghost is from He, the Holy One of Israel. It is not an it. It is not a something. But it is a Godhead that is a part of the got the power of Christ operating on the inside of you to instruct what comes out of you. That's why you got to stop lying when things happen and say, oops, that slipped. That didn't slip, that's what was in you. But if you got the Holy Ghost, whatever's in you, you got to say, because the Holy Ghost instructs what comes out of you. When you told me off, stop lying and say you didn't mean that. That thing been lying dormant in you, and all of a sudden something stirred up and it came out of you. But when the Holy Ghost instructs you, the Holy Ghost will take you what to say, when to say it, how to say it, and what to do. I have anybody up in here that the Holy Ghost had allowed you to hold your peace when you knew you had the right answer? Hold your peace. Therefore, the overflow comes from being acquainted with him. Just tell somebody, neighbor. The overflow comes from knowing and being acquainted with him. I mean, not just to know your mama's God. Young people, it's not enough to know the pastor's God or the cheerleader's God or the president's God. It's not enough to know big mama God, but every now and then, I want to know him. Philippians 3 said that I may know him, that I may know Christ, that I may know him. I want to get acquainted with him. I want to suck with him, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection. I want to know him. I want to know the kind of power, the exousia, the power, the authority, the dunamis that he has. I want to know him. I want to know when it's God and when it's flesh. I want to know when it's anointing and when it's hype. I want to know him. I want to know God to the fact that if God said it's done, it's already done. I don't want to know what you know. I want to know God. And I want to know him in the power of his resurrection. But I don't want to just know him in his resurrected power. But I want to feel him in the fellowship of his suffering. I want to be there. Just tell somebody, I want to know him. I want to know him. So Paul's point is that if you're going to experience an extravagant lifestyle, and I'm hurting, if you're going to experience an extravagant lifestyle, you got to know him in the Holy Ghost. Then secondly, young people, Paul says in verse 17 and verse 19, to wrap it up, Paul says that if you're going to experience the extravagant love of Christ, you're going to have to start sharing Christ's love. You're going to have to say, you know, one of our problems in the body of Christ is that nobody knows who we are in love with. No one knows who we're in love with. Because we praise him with our lips. But our heart is far from it. And he said, you don't love me like you used to. Because if you did, you wouldn't treat me the way you treat me. We've got to share a gospel that we serve a loving Jesus Christ. We've got to let people know that he loved us so much until before the foundation was. He had already handpicked us. He had already chosen us. Matter of fact, I believe it's Jeremiah, the first chapter, that said, when my mother was carrying me out of my mother's womb, he called me. He qualified me. He justified me. And if he did it for me, he'll do it for you. See, one of the church's problems is that we have this exclusion gospel and not inclusive. We want people to think that they have to come through us to experience Jesus' love. But the devil is a liar. He loves you because he is loving. And the moment we start teaching and preaching the love of Christ, God will open the door and the sinners will come running to Christ. And it's not about the legalistic gospel that we preach or our dogma, and I'm certainly embracing all that I am in the denomination that I am a part of. But what's more important to me is that people know Jesus loves them. And they don't have to dress up. They don't have to get into things to get his love. loves you. You can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Now, if he loves me, then I ought to exemplify the love that he has given unto me. See, one of our problems is that we don't know how to love like Jesus loves. But I release in this house unconditional love that you will love me not because of my title, not because of my position, but you will love me because God loved me. Is it anybody in here that say, I'm ready to love the way that God so loved the world? And if you're going to love like God loved, you're going to have to love your enemies. And you're going to have to show the sinners how to love the people that don't love you. We're good at loving one another because they treat us kindly. But every now and then, you got to love those that despitefully misuse you. You got to love those that stab you in the back. You got to love those that tell untruth on you. Because God says, if you just keep on loving them, I'll make your enemies be your footstool. And you don't need a footstool if you're not about to go to the next level. So instead of getting mad at you, I'm going to say thank you for everything you did to me, because I love you. I love you. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, can I be honest tonight? I need to enhance my love life. Church, who I love you, you're so easy to love.